World Time Attack in Sydney is well known for bringing international competitors from all around the world, and we're here with the LYFE Motorsport R35 GT-R. I think this is the third trip that LYFE Motorsport have made to World Time Attack, and traditionally they actually haven't had a lot of success at this particular event. We're here with Mike McGinnis from Innovate Tuning and also part-time HPA tutor to talk a little bit about the car and find out in particular what actually went wrong with their practice day yesterday. So Mike, before we get into the little niggles that you faced yesterday, which fortunately you're all over and well on top of, let's talk a little bit about bringing a car from the other side of the world and racing it at an unfamiliar track. I'm interested here, in terms of the tune, is there anything that you need to do differently? Can you tune the car in the United States, in Texas, bring it to Australia and send it out on track and know that it's going to be good?
Yeah, in this particular case, we're at a similar barometric pressure that we've operated before. So we run this car at Super Lap Battle in the United States, which is their premier event. It's in Austin, Texas at about 700 feet, not too dissimilar from where we are today. And then the car lives in Salt Lake City, Utah, where it's at about 5,000 feet. We've also run it up to about 7,000 feet in Colorado. So I built out a tune that can do all of that all in one, and it adjusts dynamically. So in terms of barometric pressure, really nothing to worry about. Temperatures within a range we've operated in. And other than that, doesn't know what country we're in, so we're good to go.
So the car doesn't care. How about fuel? Because I know there were a few issues for you getting hold of the exact fuel that you run in the United States. So what do you run? What have you had to settle on here, and how has that affected the tune?
Sure. So in the United States, we run a VP X85L, which is a leaded E85 race fuel. So 85% ethanol, and then about 15% of a high-grade race fuel, similar to a C16, which has lead in it. So what we got here doesn't have that particular additive, but it is an E85 ethanol. The percentage of ethanol turned out to read a little bit differently in our composition sensor. But the vehicle's set up as a flex fuel tune on our MoTeC M1. So it's set up to run anywhere from 0 to 100% ethanol and accounts for that dynamically on the fly. So it turned out we checked the car out at Croydon on the dyno, and I made a few changes when we ran it in practice. I just brought them right back because the car turned out to be just a little bit on the dyno than it is on the track. And on the track, it was just like old times.
And that does quite often end up being the case. The way the car's loaded on the dyno, the airflow on the dyno, very hard to replicate, you know, 180 kilometers an hour of airflow on a dyno. So there are always some subtle differences between the dyno and the racetrack. And obviously at the racetrack's what counts. Just talking about that additive and essentially the effective octane rating of the fuel that you're running in the United States versus here. Is it safe to assume that with this engine, you're not really pushing the engine hard enough in terms of boost pressure and ignition timing for it to be knock limited on just a traditional E85?
Sure, and that's actually what I ended up spending a few pulls on the dyno checking out, you know. So realized that my V should be the same, of course. Fuel properties, we weren't able to get exact specs on the new fuel. So I needed to see if my Lambda targets were still being hit. And once I saw that they were, the next thing I needed to check was how close are we to the knock limit now on this new fuel. So with a similar ethanol content, we know that portion of the fuel is effectively the same. So the other 15% I was unclear on and just needed to see how it would respond. So I added a little bit of timing, saw that we were about as far from the knock threshold as I'm used to seeing on the fuel that we deal with. Seems like great fuel. The guys at Croydon had good experience with it, which certainly, you know, gave me some confidence as well, but really seemed about the same. So that was great news and got us to the track a little bit sooner.
Okay, talking about that knock limit, and we'll just dive into this a little bit. For those who haven't really understood what knock is, abnormal type of combustion where essentially after the spark initiates the normal combustion, we get pockets of unburned fuel and air around the outside of the combustion chamber that will spontaneously combust. And when that happens, they release all of their energy almost instantly, kind of a big shock load onto the top of the piston, like someone slamming it with a sledgehammer. Obviously, it's as bad as that sounds. So we want to stay away from that. Now, generally, there's the elements that build up to create knock is heat in the combustion chamber. Anything that's going to do that or build up more heat can make the engine more knock prone. So more boost pressure, more ignition timing, more intake air temperature, or a combination of the above. So I'm just interested from your perspective when you are tuning. Most people will tune the ignition timing to achieve what we call MBT. Basically, we increase the timing until we reach maximum torque and then we stop. Are you doing that in this application, or do you purposely detune from MBT to provide a bit of a buffer or a safety margin?
Sure, and that's a decision that I usually make per engine. Sometimes it'll be determined by how much power the car makes before it starts to knock. In some cases, I'm able to achieve MBT without ever experiencing knock at all. And it really just depends on the engine system, the quality of the fuel, and again, the conditions that you mentioned. So in this particular application, we have a 4.1 liter stroker, and it's about a 10.8 static compression ratio. With the cams we have, our dynamic compression ratio is relatively high, but we have really good fuel. And I'm also not pushing the vehicle too terribly hard. I am running it up to the recommended shaft speed limit from Garrett. However, that's only about 30 pounds of boost. We're making about 1300 horsepower on a dyno jet in the US, made about 1120 on the mainline hub dyno here. And essentially, at that point, our combustion pressures are reasonable enough for the fuel. Intake temps are totally in check. And knock really isn't something I have to worry too terribly much about. So generally in this particular application, I'll run the timing up a little bit just to make sure I'm not missing on something, because the particular chemistry of the fuel that we got just wasn't something we were super aware of in terms of the gas portion again. And I didn't know how that might affect the burn rate of the fuel, right? So I wasn't necessarily looking for more power than we've ever had before. It was more just making sure I had a bit of a handle on how this fuel was going to behave.
So creep another degree on the timing, see what it responds like on the dyno, maybe pull a degree out, just kind of get a sense of what that's actually doing for the power and torque delivery.
Exactly. And in this particular case, I did add 1 degree. We did not make any more power. I didn't significantly increase knock noise either, but really no point running it if it's not going to help us out. So I took it right back out.
Absolutely. Now, in terms of the ECU you're running, you mentioned it's a MoTeC M150, and that runs a relatively sophisticated knock control strategy. Again, given that you're essentially not knock limited, is that something you're relying on as a bit of a safety backstop in case maybe something goes wrong out on track? Maybe the air temperature goes sky high, higher than you've ever seen before, something like that?
Yeah, absolutely. So in this particular ECU, I do have some safety measures which will detune the car in a passive manner just based on the current settings without reacting to knock dynamically. So if the intake air temperature gets out of control, if the coolant temperature gets out of control, which this car is certainly known to do, it's usually a one lap wonder, which Cole will sometimes like to make a two lap wonder. So in that particular instance, I will back down the boost and a little bit of timing as the coolant starts to overheat. But I do still have knock control present always. Anytime it seems to be acting appropriately, I love to keep it. You know, in certain applications, like maybe a rally car or something where there's tons of noise and gravel slamming into pans and whatnot, sometimes it can be an issue. But on a circuit, generally, that's not something I run into, so I love to keep it there just in case.
I think it's worth mentioning here that knock control is also a safety feature. It's not there as a Bandaid for poorly calibrating the ignition timing. So it's only there if it's an emergency, something really goes wrong. All right, let's jump into the problems that Cole struck yesterday. I bumped into him. He was a pretty unhappy man at the time, just having jumped out of the car after only two laps. And, well, at the time, seemed like maybe a terminal transmission failure. Thankfully, it wasn't. Can you talk us through what actually happened?
Sure, absolutely. Fortunately, in this particular case, the data was able to lead me pretty close to the issue just about immediately. I did get a little bit distracted by noticing that in a high G corner where he was sustaining over 1.5 G for a decent period of time, we had dropped a bit of pressure in the transmission. So these transmissions are a bit prone to starving in corners. There aren't too terribly many people running significant downforce in a GTR and experiencing this. So there aren't the level of solutions present that there are for some other applications. And what I was seeing was I have a 20 bar fluid pressure target. I was in third gear on the A clutch. And rather than getting 20 bar, we were dropping to between 12 and 14. So a pretty significant drop as the lateral G picked up in the corner.
Is that enough to let that clutch therefore slip?
In this particular case, we have a Dodson Promax clutch, and it's set up for a few hundred more horsepower than we were running. We also had the boost turn way down since it was our first lap, just checking things over. So in that particular case, we didn't actually slip the clutch. But what happened was halfway through the corner, he grabbed fourth gear, and this is a dual clutch transmission. So as it let go of the A clutch, dropped that pressure and tried to bring up pressure on the B clutch, there was no pressure at all. And so the TCM goes into a fault state at that point, essentially determining that that solenoid is not able to build pressure. And because of that, we lost all of our odd numbered gears. So it's a dual clutch again, which means there's two gear stacks. So we have the A clutch, which continued functioning, and that was on the even number gears, so 2, 4, and 6. And then we lost the B clutch, which would be reversed first, third, and fifth. So on that 3, 4, we had the issue. And then he was able to limp the car back in. Once he completed the corner, the pressure came back up. We stopped starving the transmission. But it turned out later that we had actually had something else occur too.
So it didn't end up being a terminal failure. What was the actual cause of that issue that you found?
Yeah, so initially I saw the starvation of the transmission, which can cause all sorts of issues. I've seen that smoke a clutch because, you know, pressure drops and it's no longer sufficient to clamp and hold the amount of torque the engine's producing. In this particular case, I do have a clutch safety strategy set up in the MoTeC, and it didn't even need to kick in. What really happened was we had a terminal failure of a seal, and it's a seal between the solenoid that builds pressure for the B clutch and the valve body where the oil pump and the transmission provides that pressure. So basically split open, no pressure to the clutch, can't clamp, and the transmission computer is able to recognize this and just determine we're not even gonna try to select those gears. We know the clutch isn't working. We'll shut you down and let you limp home.
So it actually saved the clutch because it knows it doesn't have enough pressure for the clutch to do its job.
Exactly, yeah. And at that point, it stops engaging those gears. He limped it in, and thankfully, we were able to get it to over to Croydon. They talked to their friends at Precision who had the parts to go over the clutch and then replace the seal, and we're back in business today.
So the classic example of a 20-cent part, well, figuratively speaking, letting the whole car down.
Absolutely. I mean, we probably spent 20 times in fluid just filling the thing back up to what the actual failure point cost.
Well, I mean, we're just happy that it wasn't a terminal failure and you're back up and running. I just want to talk a little bit about your strategy as well for dialing the car in session by session. Obviously, yesterday's running, as we already know, got cut short. But you've got the ability to vary the amount of power the engine's making. How do you sort of go about that to suit the driver's requirements? Are you doing that yourself, or does the driver also have in-cabin adjustment to suit their own preferences?
Sure. So in our particular case, the driver does have in-cabin adjustment. We do have a rotary pot, and we have 10 settings set up. So with the M1 ECU I'm using, it's on a beta package that does have a torque-based system. So I'm using the knob for both boost and torque limiting. Some of that is based on the gear that we're in, so that we don't overcome the tires in a low gear like second or third. And then depending on how much boost and power I'm running, I need to manage the gears kind of a bit differently. So at low power, we're able to put the full power down of that setting in every gear except second gear, let's say. But when we've got it turned up to 1300 horsepower, the car will spin in fourth if I don't keep control of it. So essentially, if I'm in, let's say, map 3 of 10, we'll have essentially full power from gear 3 onward. And then as we get up into the higher power levels, we'll limit it a bit in second and third, tiny bit in fourth, and then give it full power in fifth and sixth. Also leaning on traction control on top of that, but I try not to use traction control as a Bandaid and just give it full power all the time and let it live on traction control. Ideally, I want to be right on the verge of traction control intervention or minor interventions rather than just counting on it all the time.
So essentially you're trying to match the torque being delivered to the tire to the amount of grip the car actually has, so that there's never going to be an issue with just absolute runaway wheel spin where you've got, you know, double the torque that the tire can take, because that way, if you're just right on the verge and you do get a little bit of wheel spin, if traction control does need to come in, it's only a minor intervention.
Exactly, yeah. And in the lower power settings, I can also assume that we're not going out to put in our best lap of the weekend. So in that particular case, I'll usually keep the car a bit further away from the traction limit. And then as I turn the vehicle up in its power levels, I know it's going to be more more likely to spin just because of the extra power, but I also know that we're pushing now. So what I'll typically do is give the vehicle just a little bit more power than it can handle at that point and let the traction control provide just minor interventions. And then I also have a system that impacts the vehicle based on lateral G. So in a corner, I might back things off a little bit and keep it a little bit more under control and let it have a little bit of wheel spin coming down the straights just to get maximum acceleration out of the car at all times.
I'm assuming here as well, there's an element of track evolution across a race weekend. I mean, you turn up to the track on a Thursday, it hasn't been used for maybe 2 weeks. It's gonna be green. It was raining when we turned up as well. So it's all been washed off. And then as the track rubbers up over the weekend, it's going to get more grippy. So that will also affect your torque model?
Yeah, to be honest, I actually keep the model the same because I effectively know pretty well what the vehicle will handle at optimal conditions. And if the vehicle conditions are suboptimal, the track conditions are suboptimal, I'll let the traction control work a little bit harder unless the driver tells me, like, we're pretty far off. You know what? Let's back it off a little bit. But between the track being a little bit green and the drivers, of course, they prepare as best as they can. But when you get here on site, the car's a little different. They haven't been here in a while. They've got to get up to speed too. Also, first time for us on slicks here. First time for most folks on slicks. And so there's going to be multiple different types of rubber being put down this weekend. So I'm going to have to keep an eye on that, look at my data, and see how the track is developing over the weekend. And that might be a bit of a strategy change in the ECU tune. It's probably going to be more about just working with the driver and talking him through where I think he's got room to push a bit further.
On that note with the tyres, as you mentioned, this is the first year that Time Attack has allowed a full slick rather than a dot tyre. The dot tyre, at least as I understand them, you know, on a car like the LYFE Motorsport GT-R, really it was good for about three quarters of a lap. So it's all about tyre management. Slicks are a very different deal. How does that affect the setup of the car? Are there setup changes you'll make for a full slick? And also, what are you running back in the US for Time Attack?
Sure, yeah. So fortunately for us, we get to run here what we always run in the US.
So you've already got the data on the tire, you know it well.
Exactly, yeah. So the old setup that we used to have to run here on the treaded tire was always a compromise. That was the unique setup. What we're running today is essentially what we run all the time.
So you should be pretty much good to go out of the gate.
Absolutely.
All right, Mike, great to get some insight. I really appreciate the fact that the car is back up and running. It was one that we really wanted to see. I might have to check in later in the weekend and see how things are going, but we wish you all the best.
Thanks very much. Great to see you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.